month's lecture. It's a very interesting topic, dealing with education among the Sikh girls. The topic is trajectory of the Sikh Kanya Mahavidyalaya Firozpur. Now, a few words about the concept of education among the women in Sikhism. We all know that Guru Nanak emphasized equality for men and women. Some people do criticize there's no real equality, but I think it's better to have equality in principle rather than have no equality at all. Now, about education, I was reading that among Sikhs, there's 73% education compared to the national average of 64%. And you may call it informal, but Sikh children were introduced to reading Guru Granth Sahib by a practice called Charni Lagna. I remember as a young child, I was introduced to reading the scripture. This means boys or girls, they learn Gurmukhi script. They learn to read Guru Granth Sahib. This is formal introduction. And all Sikh Gurdwaras, they have two institutions, in fact, three institutions. One is very famous, the institution of Langar. But they also had dispensaries and Parthshala, early mandirs, mosques, Gurdwaras. They were centers of education. Now, great experiment was done by Sant Atar Singh of Mastuana. I visited that college. I was surprised in those days in remote village of Mastuana, Atar Singh just started a degree college for girls. His feeling was, if you educated girls, you educate a family. If you educate a boy, you educate only one person. So he encouraged a gentleman called Atar Singh, who has done his master's in English, to go and do another master's from Harvard. Wearing kurta pajama with flowing beard, he entered Harvard. They laughed at him. They said, no, you can't get into this university. He met the vice chancellor. He said, you're so brilliant. You are admitted. And on return, what he did? He didn't become a university professor. He started teaching in a school. That was the dedication. It's a different thing. Later, he became the principal of a college. And another great person about which Tripti will talk in detail was Bhai Takat Singh, who opened girls' school in a Gurdwara, dedicated. He realized that he is a bachelor and it will not be decent. So he married just for the sake of meeting the social norms, had a boarding school for girls in a remote area. And before this lecture, I was talking to Tripti. This Kanya Mahavidyalaya is flourishing even today. This is a great experiment. Now, another dedicated man I would like to talk is Baba Iqbal Singh of Badu Sahib. This man has done great experiment. Badu Sahib is in Himachal, in remote area, and he luckily got a very dedicated couple, Dr. Devinder Singh and his wife, medical doctor. They gave up their medical profession, and they are both devoted to girls' education. So 123 schools, imagine, mainly for girls in remote villages. That is the promotion of education among Sikh children. I think I'm trespassing the area that is reserved for Tripti. I'll say a few words about the speaker and the chair. We all know Tripti is a distinguished teacher, and she was a distinguished student also, won many medals as a student. She is teaching in Lady Sitaram College, a very distinguished college. I first met her when she was working for her PhD. She used to visit our library, and maybe I referred to her to Patela, the university library. The people were helpful, I was happy. And then we lost contact. I discovered her again after reading her article, the Sikh Kanya Mahavidyalaya Socio Historical Study, published in the Journal of Sikh Studies and Punjab Studies. And I made her a request. I said, why don't you come and share your experience? She spontaneously agreed. I'm thankful to her. There she is with us. And a distinguished teacher and administrator, Hina Nadajob, She is officiating principal of the college, and we are praying that she will be permanent principal soon. She's a good teacher, literature she teaches, and also very good translator, though she hasn't translated books for us, but I'm told she is brilliant in all fields. And I was going through the list of our articles. I said, so my gosh, it's too long a list, running into many pages. So this shows that she is committed. She is more than full-time lecturer, more than full-time scholar, and more than full-time translator and critic. So with our permission, we start this lecture, and I'll request Tripti to make a presentation for about 45 minutes. Is okay? Dr. Bersenji, 45 minutes?
Yeah. All right, sir, right.
Then the chair has 15 minutes or so. Then if possible, we'll have some questions. Thank you. Over to Tripti.
Thank you so much, sir, for your kind words. And good evening, everybody. Before I begin, I want to extend heartfelt gratitude to Professor Mohinder Singh for giving me this opportunity to discuss my work. And I'm very thankful to the Southern as well for making this research possible in so many ways. So my focus in today's presentation would be to locate the education of Sikh girls in Punjab within the larger discourse of women's education in India. And I'm going to discuss with you the Sikh Kanya Mahavidyalaya, which is almost 129-year-old institution. It is a heritage institution which endeavors to educate girls when education still remains a distant reality. And what I'm going to discuss with you are my experiences, my reflections, also reflexivity on girls' education within various social contexts. So that I'm going to discuss. So this work has emerged from my doctoral dissertation, The Social Context of Sikh Girls' Education, a study of the Sikh Kanya Mahavidyalaya, Firozpur, Punjab, under the supervision of Professor Geeta B. Nambisan at Zakir Hussain Center for Educational Studies, Jawaharlal Nehru University. I'm just going to share my screen and just a second. Is my screen visible?
Yeah, it's clear.
Yes, sir. So I begin by discussing area of my field, which is Punjab. And as erudite scholarship present here knows very well that Punjab is divided into three regions, Malwa, Majha, and Doaba. And what I'm going to discuss today is Malwa, which is thinly populated. And if we look at the overall aspect, then Malwa does not fare as well as Doaba and Majha in terms of education levels. And always the government has focused on particular districts within Malwa region as well, which have low levels of literacy, like Firozpur, Mansa, Sangrur, and Bhatinda. As Professor Mohinder Singh just mentioned about Attar Singh of Mastuana, actually Attar Singh of Mastuana also visited Sikh Kanya Mahavidyalaya, and he donated to the institution for its overall well-being, and that I could ascertain. So beginning with my work, I just want to specify the methodology very much in brief, that I have referred to historical aspects, which include, you know, looking at old records of the Sikh Kanya Mahavidyalaya. So I have tried to construct knowledge about the past and also have focused upon contemporary context, whereby I have looked at school practices and classroom processes. So in this presentation, I will be taking you back and forth to look at various aspects related to girls' education in Punjab. My study is basically ethnographic in nature, and I have borrowed from Clifford Geertz's phrase of thick description, which he has mentioned in his book, The Interpretation of Cultures. So what I have tried to do is look at pedagogical processes within the institution and also the cultural and historical context within which the school is located. So that is what my study totally looks at, how in an ethnographic way, values are transmitted through the process of schooling. And I have used various methods like non-participant observation, and I have also conducted interviews of retired teachers, principals, and all people associated with the institution in some way or the other, not only in Delhi, not only in Ferozpur, but also in Jalandhar, Patiala, Amritsar. So I have traversed different regions to basically capture different ideas related to the institution from people and also try to understand what their idea of girls' education is. So I've also referred to original school document, microfilms, microfiche, and interviews, group discussions, case studies with students. So I go on to the next slide. So this is the place from where the institution began. This is Haveli of Sodhis. And how I came upon it is interesting. It is also mentioned in Kulbir Singh Kang's book, which I came across in Patiala University. And then I tried to locate it in Ferozpur. So with the help of the school management committee member, Jaspal Singhji, where we just tried to locate different areas, we are certain that this is the same home. And we also went and interacted with the family members and find out more details about the school's past. And from here, the school moved on to this Dharamshala. So the school started in a Gurdwara. This is Gurdwara Khalsa Jubli Dharamshala. And this is an upsetting aspect is that this building does not exist anymore. It was raised to ground and another institution has come up in its place. So we have lost certain heritage monuments over a period of time because of our drive for modernization and development. So this is where the institution began. In fact, it still had some rooms which were used as hostel by the students of the Sikh Kanya Mahavidyalaya. So the school was established in 1892 and presently it is, this is also Jubli Dharamshala. So this is the school. So presently it is a government aided school and it is co-educational till class 8th and all girls up to standard 12th. So when I started my study and I went to Ferozpur, I found out, you know, I was curious why it has become co-educational. So I spoke to different retired principals, teachers, to ascertain. So apparently they said that it was only after partition because of falling student strength, they had to convert it into a co-educational institution. But nevertheless, it still goes on in strengthening the state of girls' education in that particular border region, which is very underdeveloped. So looking at the students, so this is this photograph particularly, I think is from Sikh Kanya Mahavidyalaya Facebook page and students are here to greet everybody on the occasion of death anniversary of Bhai Takhat Singh. So they are just here to welcome the guests, which is observed on 18th December of every year. And I will show you some photographs also of that event, which is looked forward to not only by the students and teachers of the institution, but local people of Ferozpur also. So looking at the profile of students, you know, there are students coming from rural border villages pinned like Dulchike, Habibke, Machiwada, Barike. So I visited all these places and also, you know, sat and had a cup of tea with parents of these students and found out why are they still sending their students. Sometimes it is not that close, 4, 5, 6 kilometers away, but still they prefer it because of the religious socialization that takes place in these institutions. So most of the students who are coming here are coming from border villages or working class settlements like Amritsari, near Amritsari Gate, where the school is located, Machi Mandi, Bhatiyan Wali Basti, Boriyan Wali Basti, Sunwan Basti. So all these are the regions. And if we look at the student composition, basically Dalit and OBC girls are studying here as well as boys. So these are Dalit students followed by OBC and then few general category students, Dalit scheduled caste students. So basically the school is catering to economically vulnerable sections, aarthik pakhon jo pichhade bachche hain. For them, the school is there. And even amongst girls, if we see there is a diminishing trend. So the proportion of scheduled caste girls compared to OBC is far greater than general category girls. Even among scheduled caste girls, we can see that participation reduces at successive stages of the school education. So higher levels of education, the number reduces. Lower levels, there are more scheduled caste girls. So this trend shows that at higher levels, they are withdrawn from education. So SKM, Sikh Kanya Mahavidyalaya, if I may use that abbreviation, still plays a crucial role in promoting the education of Dalit students. So that is how there is a continuity between its commitment from the past to the present, that even now it is catering to these sections. Now coming on, this is the school campus, and this architecture is also very beautiful. It reminds you of Khalsa College. So I tried to explore, you know, if there is anything I can find out. Then I came across that architect Ram Singh probably gave a layout of this, but there is no direct reference anywhere. So this is, these are the fields. Revenue from here is then used for overall school welfare and school development related activities. So this is the ground, and this is students are seated here for midday meal. And this hall has a lot of importance. Earlier it used to have photographs of prominent Sikh personalities, but over time now it is being used for midday meal out there. And this is Khalsa Assembly, morning assembly of the school. And this term is also very interesting. This was mentioned to me by one of the alumna who studied here in 1970. So he just reminiscing that how Khalsa Assembly was so nice, and it is an Gurmat has always remained an essential component of formal curriculum, and it pervades the school environment as well. So what we can see is intertwining of sacred and secular spaces within the school, and also how the school is able to impart Sikh religious tradition. So SKM nurtures religion and its values among students. So religion is an instrument that is utilized to shape the identities of girls. And now coming on to present, this, continuing with that, there was Satnam Sarab Kalyan Trust catering to religious education related aspects of students. Along with that, Shiromani Gurdwara Parbandhak Committee, Sikh Missionary College, Guru Gobind Singh Study Circle, all these organizations hold various events at different time of the year to cater to religious aspects that and how they need to be transmitted amongst students. So students' proficiency in religious education guarantees symbolic capital. And that is very much visible. This I have borrowed from Burdio. So Khalsa prayer also is very interesting details of which I have also mentioned in my paper, that how students, five students begin the prayer, and they start with verses of Japji Sahib. And the prayer ends with Ardas, which is the supplication prayer. So these are the photographs of the assembly. And this is of students visiting the local Gurdwara in Ferozpur. And there was an event organized by Mata Kaloji Bhalai Kendra Trust of Amritsar to commemorate 300 years of Khalsa. So various students from different schools of Ferozpur had come to participate, and then they were given certificates. So this I want to emphasize here, that school students are very active in Gurmat related activities, not only within the institution, but in Ferozpur as well. So they have contact with different Gurudwaras, and this is facilitated by the Gurmat teacher of the school. So now coming to the Gurdwara, which is located within the school. The school started within a Gurdwara, and now even there is a Gurdwara. This is a photograph of the school Gurdwara, of the building that was constructed by Bhai Takhat Singh Ji, and still it holds a lot of importance. It is the center of religious activity. It is operational during school hours, and it is totally maintained by the students and teachers of the Sikh Kanya Mahavidyalaya. So all religious texts are kept there, and they are referred by students and teachers even during free periods in between classes. So you can always find a teacher or a student sitting there and doing part. So that is very common. In fact, that is the practice that is encouraged. So there is kirtan happening, there is part, there is vyakhyan also, lectures on different aspects that are held in the Gurdwara, along with observation of masya, punya, sakrant. So all these are observed with the school, by the school community. So it is an important space of the institution. So students are immersed in Sikh rituals and observances through the school processes and classroom practices as well. So religion is the master signifier, and it gels with the instrumental order of the school. So I have used theory of Bernstein as well, where he talks about instrumental and expressive order. So religious domain that is catered to by the institution addresses expressive order very distinctly out here. Kada prashad or bhog is also observed, And after the close of the recitation, like Akhand Path, Sahaj Path, and everything is basically initiated by the students there, which is very interesting to see. So now coming to how this institution has reached where it is. Now it is not in the kind of fame which it actually experienced before independence. So let us go back to the pre-independent history of the school and see what was there, why it was such a glorious institution. So this institution emerged as a result of the social reform movement. So Singh Sabha, Tat Khalsa ideology was basically adhered to within this institution. Tat Khalsa or Lahore Singh Sabha played an important role in starting this institution, and Bhai Takhat Singh volunteered to take this ahead. So he had a very important role. Even now, local people in Ferozpur, even the lane is named where the school is located, Bhai Takhat Singh Lane. And people talk about him, how he used to go in a tonga and request people to send their girls to study in this institution. So he carries a lot of reverence and respect amongst the local people. So it started as a Kanya Pathshala, and the aim was to encourage girls to become good wives, achhi supatni and well-mannered mothers, nek te uttam swabhav wali mava. So I'm talking about 1892. And later on in 1900, Takhat Singh decided to separate it from the Singh Sabha because of some sort of politics. And since then he became the manager of the institution. And later on, a boarding house was opened in 1900. If you look at Sardul Singh Pavishar's work, which he has published on this institution, he talks about it as a pilgrimage center. And he has clicked many interesting photographs, which I can't show to you because they are not clear, but they really highlight how this institution immensely contributed to the education of Sikh girls in that period. Bibi Harnam Kaur joined Bhai Takhat Singh in this endeavor, and she played a very important role in starting the boarding school. I have referred to various issues of Khalsa Samachar, where there was a lot of publicizing being done about this boarding school, that how it is like an extended family and all needs of the students are catered to. Like Professor Singh just mentioned, so it was the motto of the school to educate a son is like kindling only one life. So educating a daughter results in entire family becoming wise. Put padhiya sordi puttar deek jaan, ti padhiya hovandi sari kul vidwan. So that is what Kavishar also mentions in his work. And another contribution of the institution is Bhai Dit Singh Library. So Dit Singh also was revered by Bhai Takhat Singh, and apparently he was the one who taught Takhat Singh at Oriental College Lahore and encouraged him to work in the field of girls' education. So Bhai Takhat Singh started a library in his name, and that library was also utilized by Kan Singh Nabha. So he used to come there. So Bhai Takhat Singh, main point is he contributed immensely to Sikh historiography by collecting Sikh documents that were getting lost. He also visited different places to catch hold of any Sikh manuscript that was just not being attended to. So this all is mentioned in Kulbir Singh Kang's work in detail. So if you look at Bhai Takhat Singh's biography, he was born in Ferozpur in a Kuka Sikh family around 1870. And later on, how he took up this whole aspect of transforming Abla to Sabha, how to empower women. And he was also conferred the title of Living Martyr, Zinda Shaheed, by British government in 1916. So all accolades to him. Bibi Harnam Kaur was born in a Sidhu Jat family, and she was daughter of an Udasi saint. And she was literate both in Gurmukhi and Devanagari. And she played a very important role. A very interesting phrase I want to bring to your presence here, that during their marriage, there was this song that was sung, Ladiyan dhitiyan bhaliyan re, kudiyan padan waliyan re, that how girls need to be educated. So both of them were passionate about girls' education. And there's another anecdote I would want to share with you, that how in 1906, Harnam Kaur, in a letter to Uttam Kaur, whose parents wanted to discontinue her schooling, said that if you were my daughter, I would not have hesitated to send you even to America for studies. Imagine 1906. So that kind of passion. And in fact, she also implored Dit Singh and Bhai Takhat Singh to start a magazine, a women's magazine, but because of lack of funds, they could not. So ultimately, the school began Punjabi Pan, Punjabi Sister magazine that is still there in the Patiala University. I have referred to many issues of that. So this is that magazine. So Harnam Kaur also dedicated her life to the institution. And in fact, girls liked to stay in the boarding house so much that they thought that going back home was like living in a cage. So the kind of freedom also that was made available to students there to express themselves within that institution is commendable. And when Bibi Harnam Kaur passed away, then Bhai Takhat Singh married an alumna of the institution, Bibi Agya Kaur. She also played a very important role. And in fact, there are certain speeches of her which she delivered in Sikh conference as well, which I have come across. So if you look at the students who were studying in that period, in fact, in Punjabi, correspondent of Bengali mentioned that, I quote, "Institutions which have risen to the public attention and success, the Sikh Girls' School of Firozpur stands perhaps the highest. It has no less than 500 girls boarders drawn from all parts of India, Khalsa Advocate 1916. So it was very popular. And despite the fact that many girls were coming from elite families, we can see that those who were staying in the boarding house, a large proportion belonged to those who were orphans, poor or deprived girls. So it was also referred to as Bernardo Home or Firozpur Ashram, where orphan girls found not only shelter, but also education. In 1902, English classes were started, and there was a letter written to parents to give permission to girls to study English. So after that permission only, they were introduced to the medium of English. So they were conscientious and ideal and chaste character teachers, Uchcheta Suchche Acharan Wale. They were encouraged to transact education to students. And it was affiliated to Punjab University in 1908. And teacher training classes were also begun. So what happened, these students who passed out from these institutions were teachers, headmistress, school inspectress, and also they joined medical profession later on. And another interesting aspect that I want to share and bring to your presence here is how this school strengthened girls' education through its commitment to this aspect, and it also strengthened girls' schools. So Harnam Kaur indirectly assisted the setting up of Guru Nanak Kanya Pathshala at Quetta. So it was like a central point. It was assisting girls' schools of different regions. Sikh Kanya Pathshala at Chunia, Lahore, at Batala, Dit Singh Kanya Pathshala at Ropar. So there are so many I came across, and this is all mentioned in Punjabi Pan, September 1910 issue. So this shows that how this school was acting like a nucleus for girls' education to spread out in different regions of the country. And it tried to unleash agency and weave new roles and responsibilities for girls. So education became a true talisman that was introduced in that period. So students who passed out served in different institutions like Rawalpindi and different places. And those who gained medical education, they went to Lady Harding College in Delhi, Medical College Ludhiana, Kinnaird College had a very important network with this institution. Many students went there, and it is also mentioned in the Colonel Daljeet Singh book that how they were in communication with Bhai Takhat Singh, and if they were in need of anything, be it money or be it any kind of assistance, he used to make provision for that. So that also evidence is available. The school also made provision for transaction of compulsory science at the entrance stage in April 1934, so that students could pursue medical stream. In fact, Punjab University Inquiry Committee 1932-33 mentions how school played a very important role in creating a base for higher education. So it says the school under private management, which they have visited, Sikh Kanya Mahavidyalaya Firozpur particularly has laudable efforts towards the betterment of girls' education. So this is in brief, you know, how alumni have achieved so much in Punjab, and the purpose was to, it is called Sikh Kanya Mahavidyalaya, to basically, so that it becomes a college, but that couldn't materialize. So this is the slide of Bhai Takhat Singh's funeral, and this was shared with me by Lavina Singh, who's great-granddaughter of Takhat Singh staying abroad. So I thought I can bring it here. Now next is, this is the photograph of students in the 1940s. After the demise of Bhai Takhat Singh, Gurbaksh Singh actually took over as the manager of the school. And with partition, just very briefly, I want to share with you that what happened, because of lack of funds, there was always funds not available. What happened is the school had to convert some classrooms into FCI godowns so that revenue could be generated for payment of salaries to the teachers. But that was discontinued. All these facts have come across basically by my interaction with the alumna who studied in that period. So basically, in the pre-independent period, it played a pioneering role in furthering women's education in different aspects. So these are some photographs of that period, and those people who are here, some of them I've interviewed, some of the teachers, so they have high reverence for the institution and the founder. This is 10th class, 1961-62. Gurbaksh Singh ji is seated here, manager of the institution. And now we come to Barsi Samagam, which is death anniversary of the school's founder, Takhat Singh, which is commemorated. Here we can see students participating in Kirtan. And this is like a very big function and they look forward to it. So this is a religious occasion whereby Akhand Path along with Bhog ceremony is held in the morning. So there is also a Diwan, a congregation comprising of Shabad Kirtan, intermixed with speeches on life and achievements of the school's founder, and also on Sikhism. So those associated with Sikh religious organizations also encourage students to adhere to principles of Sikh gurus and to accept their religion as the true religion. So this ceremony is concluded with langar, which is organized by the institution, as we can see. So coming on to the next slide. So this is, these are students preparing langar. And these are while different personalities of Firozpur are delivering speeches on the founder and what the institution now further aims, students are seated, boys and girls, that we can see here. And students also deliver lectures. So it is very interesting to see how these girls from somewhat rural areas also are very forthcoming in participating in different activities. And that is what happens because the school has nurtured that aspect within them. So as I shared, that Gurdwara component is very important. And what we see is that next to the school is Akal Garh Gurdwara, which is, and the school is now, the catchment area of the school is Kamboj Basti. Right. So basically, students there are visiting the Gurdwara in the school, as well as they are also going to the local Akal Garh Gurdwara. And what happens is this connection between the local Gurdwara and the school Gurdwara is very visible. Akhand Path that is held is during the Barsi Samagam as well as other occasions. And there's a relay of reciters repeating one after the another. And Gurpurab is another occasion when Akhand Path is conducted, also on Barsi Samagam. So what happens is initial six stanzas of Anand Sahib are read, followed by Ardas and Hukum, and finally recitation of the Guru Granth Sahib Ji. So there are, teacher basically forms a team of readers. So what we can see is that students are highly interested in Gurmat education. And this is nurtured by the Gurmat teacher of the institution as well as the school atmosphere as well. So on their own, they try to pursue diploma courses from Sikh Missionary College, from Shiromani Gurdwara Prabandhak Committee, and they share it with a lot of excitement. And they also try to visit, like before COVID times, they were visiting a religious place, Anandpur Sahib, for example, once in a year along with their teacher and learning about religious intricacies. So sometimes granthis from the local Akal Garh Gurdwara were also called to sing religious shabads. And the concluding session, as I shared, was marked by distribution of langar. So when we understand the whole school atmosphere, we see that because of the religious values, when I asked parents, why do they prefer this institution? They said that because of the values it nurtures and how it still drive students to pursue the goal of education. So even now, one alumni I came across was teaching in Dev Samaj College of Education. That is the place where I basically stayed in to pursue my research in this institution. So now also alumni are reaching to that height, but proportion is less because overall in that region, girls' education still does not get the kind of support it deserves because there are not as many government higher education institutions and parents are hesitant to send their daughters to Moga or any other place outside Ferozpur. So we see that till 12th, girls are able to pursue education here. And after that, there is a crisis because in a family, if there are brothers, then brothers' education is prioritized and they are sent to the private schools that are there. And though fees is much more, but daughters' education does not receive that kind of priority. So we can see, as Karuna Chanan also highlights, that girls' education is more of consumption luxury. And for boys, it is a matter of productive investment. So boys' education is looked as an investment. So what we see, there's a pattern that emerges that basically parents are sending their daughters to government and government-aided schools like Sikanya Mahavidyalaya, but they are sending their sons to private institutions, which are English medium. So even if we look at the profile of the institution now, you know how it is referred to by the local people of Ferozpur, they say it's a Desi school. So that's the term because it's vernacular medium. So we can see the hierarchy that is coming into the very school system and our system of education, and it shows education inequality. So that was very much visible. And regarding the different observances that are there in the institution, so these are of great interest to the students. And the Gurmat teacher also maintained a record of baptism, Sikh baptism, how many girls basically resorted to Amrit Chakya. And there was also a process where they did not comply to the whole aspect of Amrit Chakna, but some aspects of it. So that was also encouraged. But when I spoke to parents, they were hesitant. They said that we don't want our daughters to do that because then their opportunities to get into marriage and get into another family gets restricted because they have to look at then Amrit Dhari Sikhs. That becomes a difficult task. So that is how, even if girls are interested, sometimes they have to take a back step. And another aspect that is important with regard to institution like Sikanya Mahavidyalaya is that earlier many girls served as Sikh missionaries, and even now there are some who want to continue with that task. And the Gurmat teacher of the school whom I interviewed and whom I spent a lot of time with was an alumna of the institution, and she had done various programs in Sikh divinity courses and wanted to actually spread the word around regarding Sikhism. So she was basically, liked a lot by students, and they learned Gurbani from her. So that was interesting. Now coming to another aspect that is very important is how gender inequality in a way tends to hamper the very education of girls, even if they are interested. So girls would always come to me and say that, is there an opportunity for them to go for higher education somewhere? Is there any fund available? So what I want to emphasize is the state of Ferozpur. One of the person who came visiting and delivering for a lecture at the institution said that Ferozpur does not have anything with regard to employment, with regard to development. There are no industries that are being set up. So they said that because of this situation, the people of Ferozpur feel that they are not prioritized by the political fraternity, like the way Amritsar is, and Ferozpur border is closed, unlike Amritsar border, which is open, though it was open once upon a time. So that is still missed by the local people there. And they look forward to the border being opening and exchange with exchange in terms of like the way it used to be earlier. So what I want to underline here is that Ferozpur was a very important cultural area before independence. And that is visible in different documents that are available. But in present times, when I started my research, I was asked, why are you looking at Ferozpur? Why do you want to go there? And when I reached Firozpur, another question I faced was, why Sikanya Mahavidyalaya? Why don't you study Dev Samaj College, which is there and which is doing so well? They have a hostel catering to almost 1,000 girls who come from across Punjab, different parts of India, as well as abroad. Those NRI parents who are staying abroad, you know, admit their girls in Dev Samaj College. So I was asked that, you know, if you can change your topic, then rather than Sikanya Mahavidyalaya, go for Dev Samaj. I said that would be next area of my research, but now my priority is Sikanya Mahavidyalaya. So I would continue with that. So locating that institution, staying there, I realized people of Firozpur are really what they are saying. They are not complaining. That is reality. Even availability of water, if you see, if you go across, go through different newspapers, water is not, clean drinking water is not available. And situation is difficult, I remember, just to share some aspects of research also. I thought which would be interesting while I was staying in Dev Samaj College for Women guest house. Once when I returned after my field work from Sikanya Mahavidyalaya, because of too much rain, my room was flooded. And I was blessed that all my notes were kept on some height. So they did not get drenched in water. So basically with the maid, I was pushing water out of my room. So with all these facts, one fact also needs to be underlined is hospitality, love, affection of the people there that I received, which kept me going and made my research possible. So this is very interesting part of the institute. Kanya Mahavidyalaya, that I want to bring to your knowledge. And what Bhai Takhat Singh did, I think that is commendable. He played such an important role in politics as well. If we look at his contribution to Sikh historiography, to the basic, you know, basic aspect of girls' education, and how in that period he could think about empowering women, that is so interesting. And his wife, Bibi Harnam Kaur. All the anecdotes that I have mentioned are just some which I could find, but it shows her personality that she was so passionate. She had such a drive to take girls' education forward. And even now this institution in present times is catering to Dalit students basically who are studying there and border villages. Students from border villages come to this institution. And when I An interesting incident I want to share with you. When I went and met certain parents who were staying in Machi Mandi village near the border. So they said that how, you know, they are making their girls empowered. And when these students leave in a tempo from their home to the school, they tell them that you have your khand with you. If anything happens, you know how to use it well. So still, you know, these are girls going together in tempo. And in that area, also drug addiction is rampant. And when I visited family, especially near the border, so it is very visible. Even school children have access to drugs and related, things. So what makes that place is very vulnerable to different kinds of malice. Though Firozpur has such a rich history, and we know that even just some days back, we have celebrated Martyrs Day, Shahidi Divas on 23rd March. And on that day in Firozpur, there used to be a big Shahidi Mela organized to commemorate the sacrifice of Bhagat Singh, Rajguru and Sukhdev. And in that Mela also, students of Sikanya Mahavidyalaya along with other institutions participated and also read different parts of Guru Granth Sahib, Japji Sahib, along with the teacher, they went and recited these verses. So what we can see is the overall, you know, demeanor of Sikh girls that gets shaped and how their personalities get refined with an institution of this kind, which is catering to the education of girls. And now not only Sikh, but also of other religions as well, because parents who are not economically well off or they also like to send their daughters to Sikanya Mahavidyalaya because education is available, as well as other schemes are also made available, like midday meal and other scholarships for students, for Sikh minorities. All these are available. So what we can see is that this institution has contributed immensely, and there is a continuity from past to present. Even now, vulnerable and marginalized girls are getting access in this institution. Though it has become co-educational, still at the same time, because it is only for girls, 9th class to 12th class onwards, it is still holding on to its whole idea of value transmission that is very important for any community. So, and only regret, I think, while doing this research, I could realize how Kanya Mahavidyalaya at Jalandhar, actually, you know, these two, both institutions started at the same time. It became a college and Sikh Kanya Mahavidyalaya could not. So that was a regret. And I tried to ask myself continuously why this couldn't materialize. Because paucity of funds, whatever documents I came across, you know, school documents, I also took out from old rucksacks that were available in the institution and, you know, tried to find out the facts. So it was basically because Takhat Singh was a very principled person also. He had his own principles and he adhered to those. And just for funds, he just could not compromise his principles, because when there was a particular incident also mentioned in Kulbir Singh Kang's book as well, there was a particular person who was going to visit and donate, but he did not want his institution, which was only for girls, to be open for anybody. So he just refused that kind of visit. So we can see he was very passionate. He was very principled. And the torch of women's education that he has lighted, even in this present time of when funds aren't available and the school has become, you know, government-aided school and affiliated to Punjab School Education Board and referred to as quote-unquote Desi school, still is carrying on that light of education. And a very interesting saying is, of motto of the school is Vidya Vicharite Paropkari. So that aspect is very important, which we need to underline. Start by saying that girls' education that started in the 19th century enabled women to become, you know, play roles of wives and mothers, and education as an instrument allowed girls to experience autonomy and also resulted in their experiencing various innovations to apply that knowledge for betterment of their own lives. That is very visible. In fact, an alumna I met who was of 102 years age, Devinder Kaur Grewal, first MA in psychology from Punjab, who studied at Sikh Kanya Mahavidyalaya, whose friend she remembered was mother of Professor Nargis Panchpakesan, who retired as Dean of Central Institute of Education, Delhi University. So what Devinder Kaur Grewal remembered was her khadi clothes that were encouraged, that you should wear khadi and focus on education and not thinking about makeup and all these aspects and looking good. So Sabut Surat, that was underlined. And even now by various Sikh religious organizations whom I came across, I've interacted with different people I've mentioned from different organizations, that Sikh Sabut Surat is still encouraged and students are asked to adhere to that. So religion as an instrument nurtures students to adopt gendered identities, which is synchronous with their social roles. Like Durkheim says, education is only the image and reflection of society. It creates and reproduces in abbreviated forms. It does not create it. So we can see that within Sikh Kanya Mahavidyalaya, educational culture appears to be in sync with religious culture, and becoming educated also connotes the need to grow religiously. Education does not get reduced to transaction of secular subjects. It also includes religious realm, adding the sacred to the real so as to nurture social ideals. The school unravels how from past to the present times, it has not given up the goal of making girls religious minded and cultured, even though its socio-political profile has changed. So we can see the school ethos through its religious culture socializes students to emerge as religiously grounded persons. So I conclude by thanking principal teachers, staff members of Sikh Kanya Mahavidyalaya, also Jaspal Singh Ji and other members of school management committee who really helped me a lot. And lastly, I want to just quote school motto, Vidya Vicharita Paropkari. I think that is the principle our education system needs to follow in present times. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Tripti. It's a very, very enlightening for me. how one man's vision could create a harvest in the desert. And you need to be admired because you have the same commitment of sticking to the topic of Kanhaiya Mahavidyalaya in spite of incentive of better facilities. And I give you one example. There's a lady called Nadra Khan. She worked on Samadha of Maharaj Ranjit Singh Lahore. She was discouraged. You Muslim scholar, why are you bothered about Ranjit Singh? She says, this is my commitment. Once her book came out, she got so many invitations from here and there and Sikh Foundation in the US. So we're hoping that your book will come out. We'll talk about your commitment. And I think you will be acknowledged and rewarded. This is my hope and prayer. Now I request the chair in another yog to give our presidential comments. Back on over to the chair.
Thank you, sir. It is an honor to be here, and it was a great pleasure and a learning experience to listen to Dr. Tripti. I think she is a member also of a girls' college, as I am I. And we really appreciate and understand, although I think we come from different spectrums, the different ends of the spectrum. She comes from a very elite college, whereas the kind of catchment area that we would say for Vivekananda College is the kind, virtually the kind of catchment area that she's talking about, the Sikh Mahavidyalaya in Ferozpur. So we see the spectrum and we see how challenges, how challenging it is for women of a certain class, of a certain region, to be able to get education. And through this example, I think she has tied in the points extremely well. She started with the ideal, with the commitment of some people, with the vision of some people who could see the need for women's education. And, Sikhism, all the Sikh gurus have laid such great importance on education. And it's seen as the only way out of this morass of darkness and ignorance. And especially during colonialism, the colonial endeavor made Indian communities realize the disparity of opportunity and learning that they faced because of the difference with Western education. So there was this desire to bridge this by modernizing the education model. Singh Sabha did that, the Dev Samaj did that, Arya Samaj did that, we had Aligarh Muslim University talking of creating a modern institution and so on. So there was a desire that was felt to modernize the education and bring it at par with the colonial model of education. Of course, we have gained a lot from that and also lost a lot of things in that. I'm not going into that debate. But at this time, while this college itself started at the turn of the earlier century, that is the time when a lot of effort was made, especially towards the education of women. And as far as Sikhism is concerned, she has given quotes, and it is absolutely true that the Sikh gurus envisioned a society that was gender neutral, that was religion neutral, that was caste neutral. Whether we have been able to live up to the promise is a later development, and because ultimately every system, I always say this, every system is as good as the people who are manning or womaning that system, who are actually anchoring that system. So their vision was always that it should be a system of education that should bring equality to society, that should create an egalitarian society. And Sikh institutions, we all know, have done wonders in promoting education, which is modern, which is secular, which is practical. In, of course, there is also religious education, but apart from religious, which is one part of it, there is also a lot of education that is happening in various fields, whether it be medicine or engineering or any other field. That example is before us. So what I really enjoyed Dr. Tripti's presentation, because she looks at the ideals with which it began. And in fact, in one of the pictures that she showed us, there is this student who is giving a lecture, and I happened to notice the logo of the school. It is an open book with something scribbled on it with a mashal on it. So again, the very symbol is of bringing light through knowledge, through learning. And that is what is seen as the ultimate destroyer of caste, of all kinds of differences. And that ideal, I think, is extremely important to uphold. And as always is the case, there are always enlightened people in a society. There are always committed people in a society who make it their life's mission to take such a such a project forward. You know, she talks about Bhai Takat Singh Ji going from, you know, in a rickshaw and exhorting people, or Bibi Hardam Kaur exhorting people to send their daughters to school. And we are familiar with this. You know, this happens. You know, if there is an endeavor like that, that is the only way to shake off the inertia that people have, and to tell them that women's education is not a bad thing. Because, you know, and especially in 100 years ago, the fear was of creating a Vilayati Mame with all its attendant horrors. Mm-hmm. And, you know, the dread that we felt at creating a woman who was not an Indian woman. So that is why the education itself was molded in a manner that was designed to create at first obedient daughters and sisters, and then equally obedient and gentle wives and mothers. So it was a trajectory. I mean, I think we've looked at the Bengal modern of modern woman, and, you know, the development of the modern woman through Partha Chatterjee's essays, and the idea that a new woman had to be created who was educated, who could educate her family, who could be good for her family, who could be a companion to her husband, but not educated enough or not modern enough to turn into somebody who is non-Indian in that sense. So, and I at one point of time, I'd looked at some of the, you know, school books, textbooks for UP schools, you know, in the 1900s, and I'm sure that is true of books here as well. The education given to boys and to girls was very different. And that is why we also had segregated schools, because a different curriculum could be taught to them. But, you know, over a period of time, more and more institutions have become co-ed. Here, Dr. Tripti gives the example, probably turned co-ed because of economic necessity. But I'm wondering, then obviously the curriculum could not be different if boys and girls are studying together. And then what happens in schools is that we have hobbies. Mm-hmm. So we will have carpentry and learning electrical skills and other things for boys, while we'll have stitching and embroidery and things like, you know, and things like that for girls. So, you know, that those are the kinds of divisions that are so inherent in us that we automatically socialize our society into them, whether they are boys and girls. And the idea of aptitude doesn't come in it. So we would laugh if a boy wants to be a part of a cooking class, for instance, or he wants to learn to knit a sweater, we would laugh at such a boy. Whereas we still manage to accept a girl wanting to learn maybe carpentry or anything like that. So all I'm pointing out is that the inherent inequality is born out of our warped notion of what women and men are capable of. And I think it is somewhere the inability in our minds to be able to see people as gender neutral, or as people, as human beings, rather than as only men and women. So all these mechanisms were brought in, but they did not really create equality in this. Dr. Tripti also talked about the challenges of bringing girls to school. Now, when we look at all the statistics, we know that the first challenge is how to bring the girls to school. Then the challenge is how to keep them in school. Then the challenge is also how to get good results, because even if they are going to school, they are expected to do the housework in addition to going to school, not which boys are not. So they obviously are able to spend less time. I mean, we faced this problem during the COVID. Our students are desperate to come back to college, because when they come to college, they get some time off from their daily household boring chores. When they are at home, they are attending their classes online, but then they are expected to do all the work at home because they are at home. So these are challenges that girls especially face this. Now, and we have enough reports that tell us that because there are no bathrooms in schools, a lot of girls drop out, especially during the time of their periods, they do not feel comfortable in going to school, so they drop out of school. Now, okay. After all these challenges, girls manage to complete their education. As Dr. Tripti pointed out, there are no further avenues. The only two vocations that are seen respectable for women are teaching or medicine. if a girl wanted to be a lawyer, that would not be regarded as very positive. Or if she wanted to be an engineer or a journalist, that those were also traditionally, even today, people have hang-ups about asking women to go into such professions. So even if they manage to acquire an education, how to put that education to use for society? How to become productive members of society apart from the, you know, non-paying housework that they do is actually a challenge. So it seems as if, you know, this is always a work in progress. And when you look at the girls, you know, you see them covered in white dupatta, again, indicating purity, chastity, innocence, which is to be retained. And, you know, the school would have to really hold on to such values very militantly in order to attract girls, students, in order to make parents feel comfortable that the girls should be able to come to their schools because the environment there is something that will ensure their purity and that innocence for them always. So these are kinds of challenges I think that all of us are aware of when we look at when we look at women's education, and how these happen through classroom practices. I would also wish Dr. Tripti to probably shed more light on this, that how when we then come to a co-ed environment, how then we still continue to create differences subtly through nuance, through, you know, probably gesture and, you know, non-verbal cues, where we separate roles for girls and men in a classroom automatically. So those are very interesting areas. And the example of a particular school shows us the best and then the limitation of the best. That it starts with the best of ideals to provide education to girls, to make them, you know, march shoulder to shoulder with boys. And yet somewhere there is always a ceiling defined right at the beginning, which is virtually impossible to break. And I think she brings in those challenges in her presentation when she talks about, you know, what they do and how the alumni of the school go into teaching profession, or, you know, they become headmistresses and school inspectresses, etc. So the idea that there are ceilings that cannot, you know, there are skies that cannot be gone beyond. That limitation is also brought in through her presentation of these schools, while lauding the great efforts that the school is making. And I think that is a very fine balance that she is able to maintain in her talk, in her lecture, where she's able to look at both. So somewhere right at the beginning, the ideal is there, the attempt is there to take girls to a great height, to give them midday meals, ensure nutrition, to give them equal education, give them play fields, which they would probably not otherwise be allowed to go into a field to play. We see pictures here of girls playing in a field. And at the same time, there is a kind of circumference which they cannot break out of. So it is both extremely joyful and extremely saddening at the same time, to my mind. What I think is that it gives us the promise of so much, and it does empower girls. It does empower girls from marginalized sections of society who would otherwise not even have this opportunity. But somewhere it is slightly sad that we think that, you know, at least they are doing so much. And we think of that as sufficient reason to have schools like this, which is doing an amazing job, which is, and she mentions Dev Samaj College also, and girls from all over go there. But my point that I would like to add to that is that even though all this is true, there is always the reason why these schools and colleges are very popular, because they will create a certain kind of woman. They will create a certain kind of girl student who will go and fulfill the role that the elders community may have thought that she has. So those are concerns that I have as far as education is concerned. And I think this, all these concerns have been answered beautifully through Dr. Tripta's paper by showing us both the promise of great education and the limitations of that great education. And I think it is like, you know, debates like these, discussions like these that help us understand how we can take, you know, push the envelope just a little bit further so that we can create more space for women to achieve a little bit more, to reach a little bit higher. So I'll stop here at the moment and I will invite your comments, sir, and also Professor Ravel Singh. And then I think Tripti ma'am would like to say something more. Thank you.
Imagine the determination of the girls. Now these days, to go to Canada, you have to qualify IELTS. What do you call them? IELTS admission. They are matrimonial ads that a girl who has qualified, she'll pay dowry of 25 lakhs if she can bring this boy, take this boy with him with her to Canada. It's somewhere. Disconnect over here. Is it disconnect?
Haan, sir, thodi awaaz ruk ke aa rahi.
There was disconnect. I'd like to repeat. I admire the determination of the girls. These days, to go to Canada for admission, you need to qualify what you call IELTS. And I was surprised to see the matrimonial ad looking for a girl who has qualified this, and she'll pay a dowry of 25 lakhs by the boy's parents. Imagine. So girls are determined. You should not underrate their capacity. So anyway, now she wants to comment, and Dr. Vail Singh to thank.
Dr. Tripti, would you like to say something more about
this?
Yes. You'd like to say something?
Yes. Yes, I want to say that. Thank you, Dr. Hina Nandajog, for sharing your comments on my work. And definitely, as you have mentioned, there are different challenges that girls in Ferozpur are facing. And they are very visible, though they are keen to gain education, go for higher education. Still, avenues are limited because they belong to such a socioeconomic milieu that they don't have many choices. There are private institutions available in Ferozpur, which these girls cannot afford. And only if Dev Samaj College for Women is there and Dev Samaj College of Education is there that they can go to, in a family, a decision is taken. Suppose there are two daughters that I came across while doing my research. In a case study I saw, then parents, what they would do is first get the elder one, do her B.Ed. from Dev Samaj College of Education. Meanwhile, the younger one would stay at home and do all the household work. Another reality is that these are agrarian families within a lot of burden that is on girls to do agriculture-related work. So they want, parents want somebody to be at home. So usually one daughter is out there to gain B.Ed. degree, then another one is at home to, prepare all the meals and go to the fields, ensure that parents have got their meals on time. So that also comes across. And as far as co-education is concerned, what I found is, I was also wondering why it is co-educational. So when I spoke to students, interviewed them, I found out most of them are brothers to these girls or cousins, distant cousins. So it's like an extended family. So these boys basically turn out to be cousins of these girls who are studying in this institution. So these are then not seen as causing any sort of problem for the parents. So they prefer that girls are able to look after their young brothers in these institutions. So there is sibling care that is seen that, while a particular student is attending to her classes.
No, I was saying,
while a daughter, while a student.
I'm sorry, we are please aap boliye pehle, please
can't ji, I just missed out. Please repeat.
मैं सिर्फ ये कह रही थी कि नॉट ओनली दे आर लुकिंग आफ्टर द यंगर ब्रदर्स, द ओल्डर ब्रदर्स आर आल्सो एबल टू कीप एन आई ऑन द सिस्टर्स सो दैट द सिस्टर्स रिमेन ऑन द राइट पाथ.
या डेफिनेटली, एंड इट समटाइम्स पेन्ड मी टू सी दैट दीज गर्ल्स हैव टू यू नो कम आउट ऑफ देयर क्लास इन बिटवीन आफ्टर देयर यंगर ब्रदर्स एंड देन गो बैक टू देयर क्लास. So that also interrupted their education, and it is a reality. That is what they are meant to do even in school. So they do not get that freedom to just focus on education. And I just want to share an experience that once what happened, their teacher maybe took some time to reach the class, and I was doing classroom observations. So some students said that, ma'am, why don't you take our class? This is our political science class, I think 11th class. So I started with this theme of democracy. And these girls shared in such a brilliant manner that I just thought they are not in any way behind girls of Delhi. They are so bright and they are so optimistic, and their career aspirations are also so encouraging. So what really traumatizes is you when they are not able to accomplish it. You know, sometimes their parents are in such socioeconomic context, they cannot afford education of their daughters. So they just end up leaving education, and most of them even now get married after class 12th. So I think so that is the reality I want to highlight. And another interesting aspect in terms of girls playing sports, you would be amused to know that when hockey and volleyball was made available in the institution, it was open for only girls. Boys could not play these sports. So they would come to me and say, ma'am, we don't have an opportunity to play hockey and volleyball. And these girls would go and also represent at district level and win trophies for the school. So that was very interesting. When I spoke to the principal, she said, it's because they are going to leave after class 5th. So why should we take care of the boys? Because they're leaving after 5th. Earlier, it was till class 5 and then class 8. So basically, girls were focused upon and they were given opportunity to play volleyball, hockey, and won trophies for the institution. And sometimes in a particular incident, I remember a girl was kept back from going for a district level match because her family did not take as much interest in furthering her, overall passion. So that also, you know, puts you off. So research somewhere, you know, one has to be a participant at the same time, non-participant. There are different aspects of one's, it also challenges your emotional response, your, you know, how you are responding when girls are coming to you and asking, ma'am, is there any scholarship? Do you know anything? Can anybody fund our education? So we don't have answers to that because research is basically, I used to tell them that I'm here only for interacting with you and there's a particular aspect that I have, but there are no such funds available. So I think women's education, even in region like Ferozpur, needs to be encouraged, higher education especially. Thank you.
So we would like to also hear your views on the subject, and we invite you to speak on this topic.
Disconnected. What has happened?
No, sir. You're
you like to say something?
You are audible.
I'm audible? Okay. I think it's time we conclude. Encouraging thing is that this institution has retained its character, which the great institute called Khalsa College Amritsar hasn't been able to. This discipline, there is sort of basic core is intact, while because of you talk of because of materialism, because of overflow of funds, this Khalsa College Amritsar is diversified, no control, no system, no sort of sticking to the basic principles. And these people, in spite of their poverty, so we need to admire them and need to create awareness that this is an institution which has the potential to become a college. If we propagate this idea to the sick and arise, I'm sure there should be some possibility. For this, I think Tripti's work will be quite instrumental in making this great institution into a college. This is my wish. And I thank you because Dr. Ranveer Singh has got disconnected. I thank you greatly for keeping our program going. I do hope you will continue to guide the institution so that we can fulfill our basic mandate, that is promoting Punjabi language, literature, and culture. Our next program will be discussion on this book, which has just come out, Royals and Rebels, The Rise and Fall of the Sikh Empire by Lady Carl Priya Atwal from Oxford University. I'll send you the notice on time. And thank you again for coming to our rescue. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. An honor and a pleasure to be here. Thank you so much. Thank you, Dr. Tripathi.
Let us hope this COVID is over so that we can meet personally and enjoy a little more. Thank you.
Thank you.